And now, ladies and gentlemen, at the console of the museum's mighty Wurlitzer, please welcome our very own resident organist, Richard Hills.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and season's greetings to you all. Oh, it warms the cockles of an old jaded heart to see so many people here today enjoying festive cheer at the Musical Museum. A warm welcome from all of us, from me especially, and from the museum's mighty Wurlitzer, who yet again takes its turn, its centre stage, as the star of the show. Now, this particular time of year at the museum has gone through various guises over the years, and my predecessor Chris, of course, always had a wonderful show to put on with various different facets. I hope that's going to be similar today, although you're only going to get me, I'm afraid, on the mighty Wurlitzer, so don't all run for the doors immediately, but there are a few exciting things I've chosen along the way to pique your interest. And what better way to start, get us in the Christmas cheer, than with Leroy Anderson's great classic, Sleigh Ride. Now, I'm perhaps unusual in not possessing a television set. Is there anyone else in the room that doesn't have a telly? We're a dying breed, aren't we, in so many ways? But I get my Christmas fix of television programmes when I go home to see the folks at Christmas time, and you can bet your bottom dollar that at some point during the Christmas season, this movie will be on the telly box. It's a great favourite from 1938, and it includes music from Frank Churchill. So I thought we'd get ourselves well underway with a medley of tunes from Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. Once again, hope you're going to enjoy the programme today. It's lovely to see so many of you, lovely to see so many familiar faces as well. Welcome back to the museum if you haven't been since the pandemic. It's great to welcome you back, and hopefully that glass of Prosecco will have got you all livened up and ready to go for some more music. So here we go. Snow White is next. Hope you'll enjoy the show.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Boney M. Nowhere to be seen. Hope you enjoyed the little selection from Snow White, including Whistle While You Work, Hey Ho, Hey Ho, It's Off to Work We Go, Someday My Prince Will Come, I'm Wishing, and One Love. Great tunes, which even though they're so many years old, are still very much part of the Christmas scene, particularly in this country. And then we heard a wonderful carol called Mary's Boy Child, which enabled us to use some of the kitchen sink in the organ, the chimes, the glockenspiel, the chrysoglot, which is like an orchestral celesta. Truly a one-man band to be found in these Wurlitzer organs. Well, here's a little novelty piece for you now, and I'm sure a lot of you won't know it, but it's very good fun, and it bears a curious title. Again, we'll be able to show some of the fun side of the organ, and I hope you'll enjoy hearing Icicle Wingding. Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, we couldn't have Christmas without a bit of snowman, could we? And rather than just playing the famous theme, Walking in the Air, I thought we'd have a little bit of a reminder of that particular sequence. Still one of the best, in my opinion, in the whole Christmas canon. Well, I'm sure many of you will have heard of the film Meet Me in St. Louis, or St. Louis if you prefer, which starred Judy Garland. And some of you will remember that that score included such favourites as the trolley song, Meet Me in St. Louis, and The Boy Next Door. But, and here is the link, it also famously included Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas. And again, rather than just play you one song from the score, I thought we'd have a little reminder of the magic of Judy Garland at Christmas time and hear those aforementioned songs. The trolley song, Meet Me in St. Louis, The Boy Next Door, and Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas, which of course we tend to forget is quite a sad song, isn't it? But we'll try our best to imbibe it with Christmas cheer. Here's music starring Judy Garland, if you will, from Meet Me in St. Louis.
Thank you.
Thanks very much indeed. Music from Meet Me in St. Louis, or St. Louis, including the title song, and Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas. Well, it's about time you did some work for a change, and so I'm going to take the console a little bit of a way down, and if you feel like joining in, then please do with a little festive offering of carols. I hope the words will be up there on the screen for you to help. So let's close out the first half and go to interval time with a little bit of Christmas cheer. Once again, hope you're enjoying the show so far. Plenty more where that came from in the second half, a few more surprises up my sleeve as well, and look forward perhaps to seeing some of you in the break. But for now, get those lungs ready, and off we go with a bit of festive cheer. Hope you'll enjoy these.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, there'll now be a short interval. For our audience here in our concert hall, the museum's cafe is open, serving a variety of snacks, ice cream, alcohol, and soft drinks. And for the viewers at home and watching online, there's plenty of time for a cup of tea. So please go and enjoy. We'll be back right after the break. And now, ladies and gentlemen, at the console of the museum's mighty Wurlitzer, please welcome back Richard Hills.
Thank you very much. Welcome back to the second half. Hope you're all suitably refreshed and prepared to witness my jacket, which is a new acquisition. I know, if you can't wear a bit of bling at Christmas time, then when can you? Oh, and socks as well. Yes, absolutely, my wasp socks. There we go. It's all to take away from the music, you know. But hope you'll enjoy that. That was a great Christmas composition from the pen of Trevor Stanford called Snow Coach. Trevor Stanford, of course, best known as Russ Conway. I remember... Oh, there we go. Relation of yours, is he? I remember when I was a small lad, I used to have a cassette tape. That kind of dates me, doesn't it? Which was called Pop Piano and Hammond. And on one side was the Hammond organ being played by Franz Lambert. And on the other side was piano favorites played by Russ Conway, including Side Saddle and all that kind of stuff. And I was absolutely hooked on that lovely sound. And since we have such a fine piano attachment here and lots of jingle bells and things, I thought it would be a nice way to start the second half. Now, I promised you a few more treats and exciting things in the second half. We're going to have one of those next. This one is a little bit of a nerd out, I suppose, because those of you who are really into these organs, and I know there are some of you out there, you will find, I hope, this a little bit of magic from the 1950s. Now, for those of you who don't know, this organ was opened in the Regal Kingston by a gentleman called Reginald Fort. He was a real big star of the day. We find it enormously extraordinary, don't we, to think that theatre organists were big stars, but I mean, they were the Beyoncés of the day, and I'm not sure anyone quite of the stardom of Beyoncé ever played the theatre organ, but certainly they were always on the radio, and real household names. If you only think, even today, people's names like Reginald Dixon are still very much warmly remembered. So theatre organists were part and parcel of daily life, and for those of a certain vintage, shall we say, fast approaching middle age these days, the name Sandy McPherson, I think, was synonymous with theatre organ on the radio. Do you remember Sandy? He was on the air for about 900 years, from the 1930s until the 1960s. And in fact, Sandy took over the job of BBC theatre organist, yes, they had one, from Reginald Fort, and he played the original BBC theatre organ, and then BBC theatre organ number 2, as we call it, which was Reginald Fort's touring organ, because what else would you do as a variety performer in the 1930s except order a giant pipe organ and tour the variety halls of England? I mean, it's a no-brainer, isn't it? Wish I'd thought of that. Can you see it flying today, you know, playing Skegness on a giant pipe organ? Anyway, so that ties in very nicely Fort and Sandy McPherson. In fact, Sandy was on the air so often that the BBC received a letter of complaint from a disgruntled housewife somewhere like Cheam or Tunbridge Wells at the beginning of the war. And Sandy wrote this story in his autobiography, so he told it against himself. And the letter said, "Dear Sirs, I'm getting to the point where I would welcome a raid from the Luftwaffe if I could be sure that the first bomb were to fall on Sandy McPherson and his organ." Which sounds rather unfair, doesn't it? The sad twist in the tale was, actually, that in one of the first air raids on London, the BBC theatre organ was destroyed. Hitler expressed his own opinion of it. But undaunted, the BBC acquired a second one and broadcast it right up until about 1963. So you could still tune in every day, just about, and here's Sandy on the wireless. So I'm going to lower the console a little bit, and on the screen you will see a picture of Sandy, and you will hear him play his signature tune. And then, as a special guest, because this comes from a Christmas Day broadcast in about 1953, just as Fort had departed for the United States, where he later lived and worked, and you'll hear a little bit of radio magic from that time, including a brief interview with Reginald Fort himself. The pictures on the screen are either of Sandy or Reg, or of the BBC theatre organ, which Sandy played for so many years. So hope you'll enjoy this little step back in time as we are wished a Merry Christmas by Sandy and Reg. And I will take the console down with Sandy's signature tune called, appropriately enough, "I'll Play to You."
Hope you're all having a good Christmas. We're not doing too badly ourselves here in the studio right now, because besides the theatre organ and the grand piano, I've got several guests here who have, well, they've been entertaining themselves for quite a while now, and they're going to entertain you, at least we hope so, for the next half hour. I've also got some guests who are unfortunately not actually here in the flesh, but who are going to contribute to this program just the same. Now, there's one guest who is a very old friend of all of us, and whom I was hoping to have here in the flesh this evening. However, it just couldn't be managed, because at this moment he's on board the Queen Elizabeth in mid-Atlantic on the way to New York. Anyway, he recorded a short contribution for us before he left, and we're going to hear from him now, our old friend Reginald Fort.
Good evening, everybody, and a very Merry Christmas to you all. I was simply delighted when Sandy gave me the opportunity of joining in his Christmas party. Thank you very much, Sandy.
Well, it's a pleasure to have you with us, Reg. I'm just wondering about this American trip of yours. Won't you tell us something about your plans?
Well, Sandy, as you know, I've had some wonderful times in America in the past, and when I had this marvelous offer to do an extended concert tour over there, I just simply couldn't resist saying yes.
Well, no one could blame you for that.
Frankly, I've no idea at present just how long I'm going to be away, but I shall certainly look forward to broadcasting again in due course on the BBC Theatre organ.
Well, Reg, I'm sure I'm speaking for your host of friends and listeners in saying not only goodbye, but all the very best of luck.
Thank you so much, Sandy. And, you know, that's given me an idea. Just by way of saying au revoir, I'd like to play that very popular old melody, Wish Me Luck As You Wave Me Goodbye.
Whom many of you have been hearing periodically on Sunday mornings over the past 2 years or more. You know him as Mr. Drury, and he will be in the floor of Capitol Valley. He's here with us.
Thank you very much indeed. Hope you enjoyed that little bit of magic from the 1950s with Reginald Fort. And you see from the pictures, I wasn't joking when I said he toured with a giant organ and Oto drive down the streets with trucks saying that on the side. No wonder they came flocking into the theatres. But absolutely, he would do a different variety venue every week, and in those five big trucks they would load the pipes of the organ, which are all built into separate crates as you saw, and winch them out onto the lorries, drive through the night, and have the whole organ set up again in about 24 hours. Amazing, isn't it? I suppose those are the days when labour was cheap. And it apparently was a huge success. People flocked from miles around. But what happened? As soon as the organ was ordered and he started touring with it, 1939 happened, and the war put a stop to all of that, because straight away two of the trucks were commandeered by the army, and they just thought that it wasn't viable anymore. So that sadly put paid to that, and the organ was sold to the BBC, where you saw Sandy McPherson playing it back in the 1960s. Right, now, this is a family show, of course. This is not just for the organ aficionados among us, but it was nice to remember Reginald Fort, who opened this organ in 1932, I think it was. However, before the 1930s, the theatre organ's main task was to accompany silent pictures. It's rather weird, isn't it, that the theatre organ in this country came a little bit later to the table than it did in America. And as a consequence, organs like this were installed after sound pictures had been introduced. So this one, 1932, long after talkies had come to bear. But they were used as part of the variety act. People wanted a full programme, and of course you'd arrive at the cinema, you'd have your two feature films, and you'd have your entertainment from the theatre organ, maybe a bit of a sing-song, all for something ridiculous like sixpence. And when you got to the point at which you'd come into the theatre, because the show ran on loop, you'd either decide to sit and watch it again, or you would clear off at that point. So it's a very different way of going to the cinema. However, it's, I think, fascinating to note that these organs still do silent movies better than anything else. Hardly surprising, because they were designed to do that. They were the original synthesizer, and that's why we have so many of these wonderful silent picture effects. Some of you who perhaps haven't heard this organ before might did in some things like the train whistle. We have the surf on the seashore. That a triangle, little Tweety birds, horses' hooves. I think Dobbin's getting a bit tired, it must be nearly Christmas. Fire gong, car horns, doorbells, little siren, all those police chases, and of course the full marching band. All of which are real instruments. And you've seen the piano to my left there, which is operated from the organ.
Thank you very
much. And neither of them are... Which one is it? This one? Blue. I'm going to the blue microphone now, ladies and gentlemen. Can you hear the difference? There we go. Oh, no, I've got too many microphones now. What should I do with that one? Let's put it over here on the piano. You can stay there. And everything you've heard so far is a real instrument. Real drums, real percussions, real cymbals, real glockenspiels and xylophones, all operated by pneumatic hammers from the organ console. The only electronics in the organ are the wiring, is the wiring between here and the pipe chambers at the back, where there are about 1,000 organ pipes. So not bad for 1910s technology, and still, this one anyway, going on original technology, so no computers at all. So, where was I? Silent films, yes. It only really makes sense, I think, the theatre organ. It's nice to hear it in concert mode, but when you hear it, accompany a picture. And I've got just that for you, a short Laurel and Hardy film, which I hope you will enjoy. This one is called Big Business, and there is a bit of a twist here, because the big business is selling Christmas trees in California, in what looks like the height of summer. So, as ever, there's a twist, but here's yet one other facet of the museum's mighty work. Hopefully enjoy Laurel Hardy in the 1929 film Big Business.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Well, hope you enjoyed that little piece of Laurel and Hardy magic there, seeing the Mighty Wurlitzer do its thing as an accompaniment for silent film, and just such wonderful jolly japes they get up to there. Followed by one of the most famous pieces of all, made famous by the legendary Nat Cole, called simply The Christmas Song. And so there we are. Hopefully that puts you in the mood. Well, time the enemy is ticking on, and so we're going to wrap up with another great collection of Christmas favourites. Feel free to sing along with any of them that you know, but it's a bit more of a mixture this time round, and finishing with a bit of razzmatazz on the Wurlitzer as well. So, once again, great to see you here today. Hope you've enjoyed all that variety. To have a wonderful and blessed Christmas when it comes, if it comes, and until then, I hope you're going to keep sane and safe. Once again, it's been a great pleasure to see so many of you here at the museum, and I hope you'll come back and carry on supporting us. And before I leave you, I must just wish Merry Christmas and also give grateful thanks to Simon and to the team here, including Steve Barrett-White and David, who looks after the instruments, and all the team who've done so much to make this afternoon and indeed to make the daily operations of the museum worthwhile. I think they deserve a special festive round of applause. Thank you. It's so lovely to come to a place like this, which not only is a lovely venue, but also where nothing is too much trouble, and I say, oh, I want you to put something on the screen, and I want you to fade out after this amount of time, and it's all, yes, no problem at all. So thank you very much for that. All right, so hold on to your seats, ladies and gentlemen. Here's a final Christmas smorgasbord, or perhaps that should be turkey log or something like that. Anyway, you can imagine for yourself. Hope you've enjoyed the programme, and look forward to seeing you in the new year. And until then, have a very blessed Christmas, safe journey home, and look forward to the future. Thanks again.
Thanks to everyone at the Musical Museum, our front of house volunteers, our management and technical teams, our catering and event staff, everyone who's made this evening possible. Thanks very much for coming. We hope to see you again soon.